Well, good morning, everyone. Good morning. The Bible says, ascribe to the Lord the glory due his name. Worship the Lord in holy array, and that's why we are here today. So let's put everything else out of our minds, and let's focus on the Lord. Welcome to those who are watching by means of the internet. We're glad that you have joined us. We here at 29 Palms First Baptist Church are glad that you found us. I am Pastor Bob Whaley. Whatever the issue of life is, worship is the key. A holy God created us, and he knows us thoroughly. He knows everything about us. He knows our failures. He knows our likes, our dislikes. He knows our shortcomings, our insecurities, our problem sins. He knows our fears. He sits on the throne. He is omniscient. That means he is all-knowing. He is omnipotent. That means he is all-powerful. And he is all-loving. He is all of those things. And he says, I know your final destination, and I know how or where you are, and I know how to get you from where you are to where I want you to be. It is an indescribable blessing to see life from God's point of view instead of our own. The best-selling author Stormy O'Mardian shares about an extremely difficult time in her life when she felt empty and paralyzed and disillusioned and depressed. And during that time, the Lord spoke to her. And he said, simply worship me. Simply worship me. And that radically changed her life. And I quote, she says, we were created to worship God. It's a state in which our soul finds its true peace and rest and purpose, but it must become a condition of the heart, a way of life, a pattern woven into the fabric of our being. Worship must become so ongoing that it is no longer even a decision that has to be made because the decision has already been made. When you make worship a lifestyle, it will become a lifestyle. It will determine in whose image you will be formed and what you will become. Sometimes praise and worship will be the only thing you can do in a situation. You will stand and praise God while the tornadoes of life whirl around you, and you will see God move on your behalf. And when you understand this, you understand the hidden power of praise. Let's stand as we begin our worship service and the worship team leads us.
Godhead three in one. It's time to get excited that we have the gospel and we have the opportunity to share it.
And you may be seated. David says in Psalm 103, "Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me, bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all of his benefits." David is talking to himself, and he's telling himself, "Self, don't forget the Lord's blessings. It's so easy to forget his benefits, to forget how much he does for us day by day. Grateful believers will remember the gift and his gifts." And so we bring our offerings to the Lord at this time, and you who are watching by means of the internet can send in your gifts to First Baptist Church, Box 727, 29 Palms, California, 92277. And the Lord bless you as you give. Let's stand and we will sing, "I Will Bless Thee, O Lord." Lord, we do want to remember that you are the giver of all good and perfect gifts, that you give to us day by day, blessing by blessing, beyond what we even realize. But we want to be good stewards. We want to acknowledge the fact that you are the great gift who gives to us everything that we possess. And we want to bring our gifts of love, our tithes, and our offerings, and say thank you, and just acknowledge that you are the God that you are. Accept the gift and the giver this morning as we pray in Jesus' name and for his sake. Amen. And now you may be seated, and we will come to some special music by Keith and Debbie.
Good morning. I was surprised when I saw this piece of music that we're going to do now, that Debbie wrote this 13 years ago. And I don't know whether we've done this very much or not.
Not here.
But we have done it.
Yeah.
But anyway, it's a pleasure to do it now. It's called "It Must Be the Spirit of the Lord." And we should look at the things in our life and times in our life and stop and reflect about that.
Oh.
be the Spirit of
It must be the Spirit of God Almighty living in you, living in you. When you seek His face, it must be the Spirit of the Lord.
Must be the Spirit of
It must be the Spirit of God Almighty giving to you. When you receive His grace, and now when you listen to His voice, all the angels will rejoice when you call on Jesus Christ to save you. Now when your sinful life be done, keep your eyes upon the Son, knowing life is in His name. It must be the Spirit of the Lord.
Must be the Spirit.
It must be the Spirit of God Almighty calling to you. If you should turn away,
don't turn away.
It must be the Spirit of the Lord.
Must be the Spirit of
It must be the Spirit of God Almighty falling on you. When you kneel to pray,
call on Jesus Christ to save you.
Now let your sinful life be done. Keep your eyes upon the Son, knowing life is in His
Nice.
This next one, you all know, and you never know what day it's going to be, but Sunday we're going to say goodbye, world, goodbye.
And a lot of folks are looking forward to that time, aren't they? No more dishes to wash.
Oh, yeah. I like that one. Never thought of that. That's a good one.
Do you think they use paper plates in heaven? I don't think so.
This is weird.
Just a thought.
That's a good thought. No dishes in heaven. Yay. That might be like that old song, we can even eat the dishes. That would be good. Ready?
Yeah, all kinds of things.
Are we all ready?
The orchestra is behind us in the down here in the side, and you'll hear them all while we
Everybody
do this.
Say, one, two, three, four. You ready? One, two, three, four.
I've told all my troubles goodbye. Goodbye to each tear and each sigh. This world where I roam cannot be my home. Bound for a land in the sky. I walk and I talk with my Lord. I feast every day on His word. Heaven is near and I can't stay here. Goodbye, world, goodbye. Now don't you weep for me when I'm gone, 'cause I don't have to leave here alone. And when I hear that last trumpet sound, my feet won't stay on the ground. I'm gonna rise with the shout, gonna fly. I'm gonna rise with my Lord through the sky. Heaven is near, but I can't stay here. Goodbye, world, goodbye. I won't have the blues anymore.
shore. I'll never climb, for I'll leave behind my heartaches and tears evermore. But the wind made me to, then goodbye. Tomorrow I'll rise up and fly. Heaven is near, but I can't stay here. Goodbye, world, goodbye. Now don't you weep for me when I'm gone, 'cause I don't want to leave here alone. And when I hear that last trumpet sound, my feet won't stay on the ground. I'm gonna rise with a shout, gonna fly. I'm gonna ride with my Lord through the sky. Heaven is near, I can't stay here. Goodbye, world, goodbye.
I said
goodbye. Sky. Heaven is near, and I can't stay here. Goodbye, world, goodbye. Goodbye, world, goodbye. Goodbye, world, goodbye.
Thank you.
Thank you, Keith and Debbie. I don't know, do you think Apostle Paul taught the Colossians that kind of idea? Goodbye, world, goodbye. Well, maybe he did. There's a lot we don't know about the Colossians. We're going to start a new series in the book of Colossians today. So take your Bibles and turn to the book of Colossians, and we're going to cover chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. Chapter 1, verses 1 through 14. I'm not going to read it now because we're going to read it as we go along. It would be just too much to do all at one time. And so we're going to begin by looking at the opening of the letter, which tells us something about the people who lived in Colossae. It begins, first two verses, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus, by the will of God and Timothy, our brother, to the saints and faithful brethren in Christ at Colossae, grace to you and peace from God our Father. I think it's important to notice that peace doesn't come until God's grace is first. Paul mentions that in this order. Grace to you is first, and then the peace comes after that. And so that's how Paul begins the book of Colossians. We're going to look, first of all, at the city. And my wife and I were there at the city, not at the actual location, because the location is underground. It hasn't been excavated yet. But let's look at this overview of the map. Let's see if my little pointer, my laser pointer, will work if I go like that. There it is. We can see Pergamum. There is one of the churches of Revelation. And then here's Thyatira. And then we can go over here to Smyrna on the coast. And let's see, there's, I can't read it, small on my computer, it's Sardis. And down here is Ephesus. That's the major city of the seven churches. Paul spent 3 years in that city. And then over here is Laodicea. And then Colossae, and that's where Paul is addressing this letter. So we'll zoom in now, and these three cities are all located in the Lycus River Valley, and the Lycus River flows by these cities, and it empties into the Meander River. And have you ever used that expression, meander? You're shopping and you say, well, I'll just meander in this store for a little while. It comes from this river, which goes like this, all the way to the sea. it meanders there, and so that's where the expression comes from. So these three cities form a triangle, and Colossae is 10 miles from Laodicea, and it is 13 miles from Hierapolis. We were privileged to go to the seven churches, but we stayed overnight in Hierapolis, and that's another interesting city. And we'll show you some of that here. Here is us. We're standing in front of the ruins of Laodicea, the last of the seven churches of Revelation, the lukewarm city, according to the book of Revelation. Now, if I can get my pointer to work again, right here, do you see this little white spot right there? That's Hierapolis. And Hierapolis is famous for its white, chalky cliffs and hills because of the mineral waters that flow there very copiously. And then we are going to move from Laodicea. Now we are in Hierapolis, and this is only a small section of the ruins in Hierapolis. And, come on, get my pointer to work. It didn't work this time. You're going to have to take my word for it. In the background, in the foothills, just below the foothills, that's Laodicea. That's where we were. We were looking across that valley to Hierapolis. Now we are in Hierapolis looking across the valley back to Laodicea. And this is a photograph of a poster in Hierapolis, which features what they call the travertines. These are many pools, and they are all white from the minerals of that area and the mineral waters that bubble up out of the mountains. And it's famous. People go from all over the world to this place, to the mineral baths. And so that's real close to Colossae. Now we'll go back to our overview map. And as I said, Colossae has not yet been excavated, so we didn't even bother to go there. But it's only a few miles down the valley from where we were, and so we could look at the area. This whole area is a Roman province. The Romans were in control. The Lycus Valley was a large populated area. It had great wealth, and it was famous for wool. I thought back to when we traveled in Oregon. We went to Pendleton, Oregon, which is famous for wool. And I bought a Pendleton wool shirt. Well, this area was the same way. It was famous for its wool. And in about 60 AD, a major earthquake hit, and it really hurt the city of Colossae. And so the trade route was relocated, and the town diminished after that to the point where it was abandoned and then buried. It never came back. And so this is where the people are located, where Paul is writing the letter. Let's look at the church. In verse 2, Paul says, "To the saints and faithful brethren in Christ at Colossae." It was a Pauline church, but Paul was not the founder of this church. No, Epaphras was the founder, and so Paul writes in chapter 2, verse 1, "I want you to know how greatly I strive for you and for those at Laodicea," notice their sister congregations, "and for all who have not seen my face." So many in the Colossian church had never seen Paul. Paul did not start the church. Epaphras did, and you will see him mentioned in chapter 4, verse 12, where Paul writes, "Epaphras, who was one of yourselves, one of you Colossians, a servant of Christ Jesus, greets you." Epaphras was saved in Ephesus when Paul had his three-year ministry there in Ephesus. And then he came back to Colossae, and he began a kind of a missionary emphasis. He won people to Christ and started a church in Colossae. See that in verses 6 and 7. From the day you heard and understood the grace of God in truth, as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. So that's how the church got started. It was through the ministry of Epaphras. And then after about a 5-year ministry there, heresy began to creep into the church. And all kinds of foreign thinking crept into the church. And apparently Epaphras was not able to filter that out of the church. It got into the church, and so Epaphras goes to Rome, and he tells Paul, who was in prison in Rome, about what's going on in Colossae. And so Paul writes this letter of Colossians to the people and the church at Colossae. Paul writes this letter, and he has nothing but praise for Epaphras, and he backs him 100%. Now, we are a Pauline church. We read the letters of Paul in the New Testament. Paul wrote about half of the New Testament. And so that makes us a Pauline church. But like that church in Colossae, the world is trying to creep in. It's trying to make an emphasis on our thinking and trying to get us to live more like the world. And so our job is to witness to our web of influence, like Epaphras witnessed to his own family and his townspeople. And sometimes it's not that easy to witness to your own family members, is it? But that's what we are called to do. And that's what Epaphras did. It was also a Gentile church. And we see that in verse 21. And you who were once estranged and hostile in mind. Now he's describing Gentiles. And that's exactly how Paul described them in the book of Ephesians. He says in Ephesians, remember, you Gentiles were separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in the world. Folks, that describes Gentiles today. This is a Gentile country we live in, a Gentile community we live in. And the people outside of the church, those who don't know God, are without hope, just like Paul mentions in the book of Ephesians, without hope and without God in the world. He continues in Colossians 1, verse 27, God chose to make known how great among the Gentiles are the riches of the glory of his mystery, which is Christ in you. Paul was the apostle to the Gentiles. Aren't you glad that God sent Paul to the Gentiles? We are Gentiles, at least as far as I know, all of us are. And Paul wrote half the New Testament to us so that we could minister to other Gentiles. And so it was a Gentile church. Furthermore, it was a troubled church. Heresy came in, and the heresies are not well spelled out in the book of Colossians, but from what we know of history and from what we can gather from comments in the book of Colossians, we can say several things about this troubled church. First of all, we are told that philosophy was brought in. If you will look at chapter 2, verse 8, he says, see that no one makes a prey of you or a victim of you by philosophy and empty deceit. He actually uses the word philosophius in the original language. And it referred to human traditions. And today we would call it humanism. Humanism focuses on mankind and what we can do. Everything's in our hands. We are in charge. And it leaves God out of the picture. And that's what Paul is saying about the philosophy that crept in to the Colossian church. All the worldly systems of that day were creeping into the church. Furthermore, there were ritual and dietary days and holy days, as he mentions in chapter 2, verse 16. He says, "Let no one pass judgment on you in questions of food and drink, or with regard to a festival or a new moon or a Sabbath. These are only a shadow of the things to come." So Paul was saying you put too much emphasis on ritual and dietary laws and holy days. And then there was a hierarchy of supernatural powers that they were now focusing on. And we see that in verse 8 of chapter 2. "See that no one makes a prey of you by philosophy and empty deceit, according to human tradition, according to the elemental spirits." That's what we're focusing on here. "The elemental spirits of the universe, and not on Christ." He repeats that in verse 20. "If with Christ you died to the elemental spirits of the universe, why do you still live as if you still belong to the world? You're supposed to have died to those things." And so what does elemental spirits refer to? It's referring to these powers. The word stoicheia, the basic meaning of the word meant things in a row, ABCs, 1, 2, 3s. And from that, other meanings evolved from that. For example, they use it to refer to the four elements. You've heard of that. Most of history, pagan nations have said that the world is composed of four elements: earth, wind, fire, and water. In fact, there's even a contemporary band called Earth, Wind, and Fire. And so that was coming into the Colossian church, these elemental powers over the world. The King James Version translates elementary powers as the rudiments of the world. The New American Standard says the elementary principles of the world. The New King James says the basic principles of the world. And these powers included worship of angels, and they are mentioned in chapter 2, verse 18, where Paul says, "Let no one disqualify you insisting on self-abasement and worship of angels." But that was creeping into the church. And things like astrology were creeping into the church with its 12 houses, you know, the division of the circle of the earth into 12 houses. And astrology is basically nothing more than a form of divination, which is commanded to not do in the Old Testament. So all of this is going on in the Colossian church, and furthermore, they were saying there were various divine beings in addition to Jesus that they had to pay attention to. I'll come back to that one. One other thing that had crept into the church was asceticism. Let's look at verses 20 through 23. Chapter 2, verse 20. "If with Christ you died to the elemental spirits of the universe, why do you live as if you still belong to the world? Why do you submit to regulations? Do not handle, do not taste, do not touch," referring to things which all perish as they are used, "according to human precepts and doctrines." Why do you do that? "These have indeed an appearance of wisdom in promoting rigor of devotion and self-abasement and severity of the body, but they are of no value in checking the indulgence of the flesh." And so asceticism, the Greeks made that contribution because they said the body was basically evil and the spirit was good. And we are to put down the body and we are to focus on the spirit. And this asceticism included strict self-denial and man-made rules. So if you were an ascetic, you were kind of like going on a diet for God, denying yourself this and denying yourself that. The black shadow of asceticism spread over the Puritan fathers in our country in the early days. So given the choice of two coats, a Puritan would choose the ugliest one. given two colors for the woman's clothes, they would choose the saddest and the somberest. Given two roads, they would choose the one that held the most thorns and the most cutting rocks. Given two forms of fear and self-denial, they would choose both. The favorite text of the ascetic was deny yourself. The favorite color of an ascetic is black. The favorite music is a dirge. Its favorite hour is midnight. Its favorite theme is a tombstone. And the mistake of asceticism is in thinking that it has some kind of moral value. It does not. And so again, verse 23, Paul says, they have indeed an appearance of wisdom in promoting vigor of devotion and self-abasement and severity to the body, but they are of no value in checking the indulgence of the flesh. And so that's what was going on in the Colossian church. It was a troubled church. This troubled church had three basic elements contributing to all of that. There was the Jewish element, and that led to the rituals and a lot of the asceticism, denying yourself and so forth, legalism and ritual. And there are a lot of legalists in the church today. I don't know this church that well, but there could be some legalists here who want to go by the book, go by the rules. And they seem to say, just follow the rules and God will owe you. The prosperity gospel preachers are saying that. If you just do this and that, God will bless you. He has to bless you because you follow the rules. And so that was one element in this church. A major element in the church was the pagan element, which included theosophy, this mystical insight, and astrology, and also Gnosticism. And Gnosticism gets its word from the Greek word gnosis, which means knowledge. And Gnosticism said that you had to have a special knowledge in order to be saved. And they had it. And you had to go to them. So they were like a secret club for those that have insight. And they too said that matter was evil. It's basically another Greek idea. Matter is evil, and only the non-material is good. And so their question was, how can a pure God create an evil world? The two don't mix. Good God, evil world. God cannot communicate directly with that evil world, and so they created what were called emanations of God. These were lower beings that came from God to the world to be in betweens between God and the evil world. Emanations was the contribution of Gnosticism. How can deity be joined to human body? And therefore, they denied Jesus is God. Because Jesus can't be God and have a body. And so they denied Jesus. That was coming into the Colossian church. And there are people today that are denying Jesus, maybe not in that way, but they are coming into the church denying Jesus. Today, people have given Jesus an honorable place, but not his rightful place. He is not supreme in their daily life. And so I must ask, what about you? Is Jesus supreme in your life? I have to ask myself, is Jesus supreme in my own life? Is he just included, or is he the central focus? Is he some kind of STP, a spiritual STP that you put in your gas tank, an additive to what you already believe as a Christian? Today's troubled churches have all of these same elements, and the syncretism is combining all of them and bringing them into the church. In spite of all of this that is going on in the Colossian church, Paul is thankful for them in verses 3 through 8. So let's go back to chapter 1 and look at verses 3 through 8. We always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, because we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love which you have for all the saints because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Of this you have heard before in the word of the truth, the gospel which has come to you, as indeed in the whole world it is bearing fruit and growing. So among yourselves, from the day you heard and understood the grace of God in truth, as you have learned it from Epaphras, our fellow beloved servant, he is a faithful minister of Christ on our behalf and has made known to us your love in the Spirit. And so notice how Paul throws out thanksgiving to these believers in the Colossian church. Well, for one thing, thanksgiving was standard in letter writing. You always began your letter with some kind of thanksgiving. You could always find something to be thankful for. Even naysayers can find something to be thankful for. And so Paul is doing that in the letter, but he is also thankful in his spirit. So, in chapter 1, verse 12, he says, thanks to God the Father. In chapter 2, verse 7, he says, abounding in thanksgiving. Chapter 3, verse 15, he says, and be thankful. Chapter 3, verse 17, do everything in the name of the Lord Jesus, giving thanks to God the Father through him. And then in chapter 4, verse 2, being watchful with thanksgiving. So he was plenty thankful in his letter concerning the Colossians. He practiced what he preached. In Ephesians 5:20, he says, give thanks in all things. There is always something to be thankful for. Even as we turn on the news, there's always something to be thankful for. And so he finds that in the Colossian church. Now, this thanksgiving was addressed to God, as you notice in verse 3. We always thank God. Amen. God is the one that makes things happen. Glory. The Gnostics could not go directly to God. They had to go to God through these emanations of spirits. Their prayers had to go through the chain of command. But as Christians, we go directly to God with our thanksgiving. And that's what Paul does. And God makes things happen. But the Gnostics could not do that. They are just like the atheist. Who does an atheist thank when he's thankful? He can't think of anybody but himself, can he? Paul thanks God. Specifically, Paul thanks the Father of our Lord Jesus. Jesus has made God known to us as a Father, as he writes in verse 2. And so that makes us children of God, and that's what the Apostle John emphasizes in the first chapter of his letter. John 1:12, he says, to those who believe, he gave power to become children of God. And in his little letter of 1 John, the apostle says, see what love the Father has given us, that we are children of God. Amen. Jesus is the begotten Son of the Father. We are his adopted children. And we have the same rights and the same privileges as Jesus, God's Son. Paul gives us his reasons for gratitude. In verses 4 and 5, it's their welfare. He thanks God, first of all, for their faith, their love, and their hope. Paul mentions those three. It's a triad of faith, love, and hope in almost every letter he writes, except the book of Galatians, where there is a real problem with that church. Otherwise, he mentions faith, hope, and love in all of his letters. Faith is Christ's word. It's the vertical dimension. Love is man's word. It's our horizontal relationship. They are both important. The horizontal and the vertical are both just equally important. And then he mentions hope. Hope anticipates the future. It's forward looking. And so he's grateful that they have this faith, hope, and love as a church body. Notice that Paul heard it from Ephesus. I hear that you have faith, hope, and love, he writes. He's also thankful for their progress in verses 5 and 6. They are bearing fruit and they are growing. I remember when Jesus told his disciples, I am the vine and you are the branches. And the branches can't survive without the vine because they get their sustenance, their nutrients from the vine. And then he says, the branches, the purpose of the branches is to bear fruit. I am the vine, you are the branches. A branch that does not bear fruit is pruned by the vine dresser. And so that's the purpose of a Christian, is to bear fruit and to grow. Bear in mind that these are the same Christians that have all these problems in the church. And they're all being influenced. They're baby Christians, and they're still going after this rabbit track and after that rabbit track. But Paul is still thankful because they are growing. God loves us the way we are, but he doesn't want to leave us there. He wants us to grow beyond that. We are all at different growth levels in the church. But Paul can be thankful for each member who is growing. And we too need to be thankful for the members that are growing in their faith, hope, and love. He is also thankful for the work of Epaphras in verses 7 and 8. Epaphras taught the Colossians the gospel. And Paul is so thankful that one of his understudies would go to another community and start a church. Let me ask you, can anyone be thankful for you and your ministry and your witness? Has your witness gone out? Have you affected somebody else for Christ so that thanksgiving can be made for you? That's what's going on in this letter of Paul to the Colossians. The last thing we're going to look at this morning is Paul's intercession for them in verses 9 through 14. Let's read that. And from the day we heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you, asking that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, to lead a life worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, bearing fruit in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. May you be strengthened with all power, according to his glorious might, for all endurance and patience with joy, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. He has delivered us from the dominion of darkness and transferred us to the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins. And so Paul prays this wonderful prayer for the Colossians. How do you pray for others in your community, in your sphere of influence? How do you pray for others? Paul's prayer is a good model for us to follow. These folks are on his prayer list, and he doesn't forget to pray for them. And he prays in response to the news he gets from Epaphras while he's in prison in Rome. He responds with intercession. And so real prayer is, it's not good food, good meat, good God, let's eat. Real prayer thinks of the needs of others and makes intercession for them. And so Paul prays that they will have a knowledge of the will of God. What do we pray for? Do we pray for our personal convenience? Do we pray for our own comfort level? Or do we pray for the real needs in our life and those around us? He prayed for their knowledge of the will of God. That was a kind of a foundation for witness. Secondly, he prayed that they would lead a worthy Christian life in verses 10 to 14. The word worthy there means equal in weight. And of course, the scales in those days were balanced scale, and so he's praying that the two should be equal in weight in verses 10 through 14. To lead a life worthy of the Lord, the life should be equal in weight to the calling of the Lord. How does that look? Well, in verse 10, he says it will include bearing fruit. Fruit bearing, which includes good works for the Lord. It includes service in the church. It includes the Lord's work of all kinds. It also includes that increase in knowledge. He is praying for their personal spiritual growth. He knows they had a good beginning, but he knows these other influences are all around them. And they're baby Christians and they need to grow. Don't stop praying just because the person's a brand new Christian. Just because he's got into the kingdom doesn't mean he's got it made. He's got a lot of issues he's got to face. So pray for those things, that people will increase in their knowledge of the Lord and Savior. The third thing he prays for is that they will strengthen in their power. That is, in God's power. Life is not meant to be lived on our own power. Amen. But so often, that's what we do. And that's probably what the Colossians were doing too. And so he prays that they would not live in their own power, but that they would live in God's power. And then finally, in 12 through 13, he offers thanks. Thanks to a loving Father. The loving Father makes it all possible. He makes it possible for us to live in the kingdom of God. And he says that he has qualified us, he has delivered us, and he has transferred us. These are three verbs that are in the perfect passive tense, which means something that happened in the past with results that continue up until the present. And that's how he's describing these Colossians. As we read in 12 and 13, he says, giving thanks to the Father who has qualified us, perfect past tense, he qualified us in the past, and we're still qualified to share in the inheritance of the saints in light. He has delivered us. We have been delivered in the past, and we're still delivered from the dominion of darkness, and he has transferred us. We were transferred from the moment we believed up until the present into the kingdom of God's beloved Son. In verse 13, what Paul is saying is he gave us a transfer ticket from the tram to hell to the train to heaven. Hallelujah. From the dominion of darkness to the kingdom of light. Through Jesus Christ, who is described as already accomplishing these things. And that is amazing for us who are Gentiles. God has done that for us Gentiles. We have been transferred from the negative to the positive. We've been transferred from debit to deposit. We have been transferred from the citizenship of one country into the citizenship of another country. We have been transferred from Egypt into the promised land. We have been transferred from the promise of Satan to the promise and love of God. We have been transferred from the dominion of darkness into the kingdom of God. And for that, we can give thanks. Yes, amen. Let me summarize as far as we've gone, and this is where we have to quit for today. Paul begins with the church. It is a Pauline church. It follows the writings of Paul in the New Testament. It is a Gentile church, much like us today, but it is a troubled church. And we as a church live in troubled times, and those troubles creep into our church as well. Paul gives thanksgiving for these new Christians who are struggling to find their way as Christians. His thanksgiving is heartfelt, not just a form letter. It is addressed to God, who makes it all happen. And he prays and thanks God for their growth. Finally, we see his prayer, a model prayer for us. He prays for them to live worthy, to live equal in weight to their calling as Christians, since they have already been qualified, already been delivered, and already been transferred into the kingdom of God. Praise God. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this beginning to the book of Colossians and how much it has already instructed us and how much it has challenged us and it lifts our spirits. As we continue to plunge into this book, may we mine all that you have for us. May we take it to heart. May we profit and prosper from it all. And I would thank you and praise you in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to close as we stand now and sing our final hymn. Let's sing. This concludes the service, so I ask you to have a great week, and we close by saying, may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Amen, and God bless.